Good afternoon and welcome to the last lecture in our Siam series. My name is Laura Muldowney and I'm the curator of Chester Beatty's Siam exhibition. And today I'd like to welcome back Betty Yao, who co-organized the Traveling Siam show. As many of you know, earlier in the year, Betty gave a lecture as part of our public program, which focused on John Thompson's trip to Siam and other regions in Asia. And today she's going to round out the discussion by looking at his life and legacy after he returned to the UK in 1872. Just to say though, before we start, unfortunately the exhibition will be closing this Sunday on December 6th, and it's a real pity that it wasn't open longer to the public, but I do hope you were able to tune into some of our online activities in relation to the exhibition, including the virtual exhibition, which will in fact stay on our website after it closes. And if you do have time in the next few days, you can still come into the exhibition and take a look at it. It will stay open until Sunday at 5:30. Also, just to point out quickly that if you do have questions, just click onto the Q&A tab at the bottom of your screen and you can type in your question, and at the end of Betty's talk, she will respond to your question. So thank you again, Betty. We really look forward to it. And over to you.
Thank you, Laura. And thank you all for joining in. As Laura said, this lecture picks up the story from my last talk on Siam, which is still available online. But some of you will maybe be joining for the first time. So I'd like to do a recap on John Thompson's early life. And because his first 10 years, Siam and his China photographs, they're crucial to the rest of his life and his legacy. So first slide, please. Okay, screen. All right. So can we have the next slide? So John Thompson was born in 1837. You'll see him on the left. This is a photograph taken in China. There are not that many photos of him from his early life. So he was born in 1837, which is only 2 years before the birth of photography. He was born in Edinburgh and he wasn't from a wealthy family. So as a teenager, he became an apprentice to an optical and scientific instrument maker. And that was his luck because that's how he learned about photography. But being a really hardworking young man, he took evening classes at then the Edinburgh School of Arts, which is today Heriot Watt University in Edinburgh. And after 8 years of apprenticeship, Thompson moved to Singapore. This is to follow in the footsteps of his brother who went out there some years earlier. Of course, the colonies opened up many new opportunities for ambitious young man who didn't have great means. And one thing I just want to say up front, and because that will have an impact on the rest of his life, was Thompson was very good. Today we call it networking. So he's a good networker and he was really good with people, very sensitive and in his dealing with people, and he had many friends. And this helped him to tap into the huge Scottish diaspora in the colonies, because people often ask the question, well, how come he got access to these people and to photograph these places? Well, is that link with the Scottish diaspora. Okay, next slide, please. So in Singapore, he always wanted to go and visit Siam, which is Thailand today. And so in 1865, he sailed to Bangkok. And at that time, Siam was under the reign of King Rama IV, King Mongkut. And because at that time, Siam was very open to and interested in Western technology, and it's because of King Mongkut. And you will know of him as the King and I King. And also King Mongkut was personally very interested in photography as well as other Western things. And so Thompson bringing the chemical and optical techniques of photography was opened up lots of doors. And with the help of the British Council, quite soon after his arrival, he got the permission to photograph the king. And here you see in the slide that on the right, you see him in his coronation robe. And on the left, you see him in, this is a gift from Napoleon III. This is the uniform of a French field marshal. And as you may all know the King and I story, King Mongkut actually met for 20 so years before he ascended to the throne. He was in a monastery. He led the life of a monk, but he was taught by missionaries as well. And that's how he learned English, and he learned all about the Western sciences. And that's where the interests lie. And next slide, please. You will see, next slide. Oh yeah, here. It's a lovely photograph of Prince Chulalongkorn, later to become King Chulalongkorn, who's one of the most important kings, a real modernizer of Siam. Next slide. Zipping through. This is Mom Ratchachai. His father was one of the princelings, and as a young boy, he was actually given to become a companion to King Mongkut. And so they spend all those years together in the monastery, so in monkhood, as it were. And he also learned English. So he was very often asked to speak with dignitary foreign visitors to the court. And I was interested, I wanted to show you this image because later on we're going to discuss Thompson's legacy. Certainly Thompson, at this very early stage of photography, was trying new things. At a time, I'm sure many of you would have seen Victorian photographs of sitters looking, you know, very stylized, very stilted. Here you see this prince looking very relaxed, casual. And I want you to have a look at his wonderful shoes, which look very, very modern. Next, please. Because Thompson got on very well with the king, he was granted unparalleled access to photograph not only the royal family, but for us, some of the most precious photographs in this collection are the royal ceremonies. And here I just want to show you one. This is a humongous photo of the king bringing clean robes. This is Lenten robes after the summer, rainy season, monsoon season. Everyone, all families would donate clean robes to their local monastery, of course, with King Mongkut. This was a huge procession. But I wanted to show this for you to imagine it's such a huge cast of characters. Literally, King Mongkut had to ask everyone to stop, stay still for maybe 20, 30 seconds to allow John Thompson to take the photograph. So it was a great, great honor for Thompson to achieve, you know, many royal ceremonies photographs and capture those images. Next, we have a huge photograph of a Siamese orchestra. And here you see the dancers, and both the male and female roles are danced by women. But you can clearly see in the middle there, with the long fingernails and the detailed elaborate costumes. Let's have a look at the next slides. So this is January 1866, and Thompson, who was inspired by an account written by a Frenchman called Henry Moore, about discovering this amazing complex in Cambodia. Of course, today we know it as Angkor Wat. And Thompson was able only to visit Cambodia because King Mongkut gave him a letter of introduction to the Cambodian king, so he was able to have access. But this slide shows that Thompson and the elephants, which carried all his heavy equipment, and you can imagine it was such an arduous journey by boat, then by elephants, trekking through the jungles. But it was all well worthwhile because he will always be remembered as the first person to have photographed Angkor. Next. Yeah, I'm just going to show you one image from this collection. This is the main entrance to Angkor Wat, across the bridge, the Naga Bridge, as the main entrance to the complex. And so Thompson returned to Bangkok and he gave one set of the glass negatives of Cambodia to King Mongkut. And in May in 1866, he sailed back to Britain. Okay, next. So back home, so I purposely picked this page from his book, his first publication back in the in Britain, because he wanted to establish himself, his reputation. And this is from a large photographic album called Antiquities of Cambodia, and this was published in 1867. And with these credentials, these rare photographs, he was invited to become a fellow of the Royal Ethnological Society, and more importantly, the Royal Geographic Society, which we're going to discuss a bit later. He also gave many lectures up and down the countries, in London, in Edinburgh. And at one of these lectures, he actually met his future wife, Isabel Petrie. She's the daughter of a South Sea captain. So therefore she was game to join him to go back to the Far East, and setting sail in 1867, and they were married in Hong Kong. So next image, you'll see Thompson's now back in Hong Kong. In case some of you may have visited, this is Devereux Road, which today you see the tram line run along this road. But in this Thompson photograph, it's next to the harbor. But of course, when you visit the same place today, you'll see it's many, many, many streets away from the harbor. So that's to show you how much land has been, you know, filled in. Next photo. Then within a very short time, Thompson was able to get a commission to take photographs of for a commemorative book for the first royal visit to the colony of Hong Kong. And this was the Duke of Edinburgh, he's the younger son of Queen Victoria. And we'll see some of his family later on. This commission really sealed his reputation in Hong Kong. And this you see is Lyndhurst Terrace, all decked out in lanterns and banners to welcome the Duke. Next image, I'm zipping through the Hong Kong ones. This I just thought to put in case you might find it interesting. So on the left is a Thompson photo of Pedder Street. And on the right, you will see it's the same from the same vantage point. This is Pedder Street. Of course, that beautiful clock tower was demolished a long time ago. But what I wanted to point out, if you see on Thompson's photo, you see those sedan chairs? Well, they're the taxis of their day. But on the right of this same photo, street, you see this is a taxi stand even today. So obviously this is a good place to get customers. So Thompson had a very successful flourishing business with his studio in Hong Kong, because most British officials and merchants would commission a set of studio photographs of themselves before they finished their stint in the Far East. So Thompson made a good income. But the next set of slides that I'm going to show you will be of China, and they were all taken, paid for out of his own pocket and because of his own interest. And those photographs would be mainly from 1870 to 1872. This is because 1870, Isabel was pregnant again with the second child, and therefore they decided it would be better for her to return. So she sailed back to England, where she would have more care and support. And therefore Thompson was free, and he sold his studio and he used these funds to pay for the travels. And so next, let's have a look at his So before we get to the China slides, I think it's important, even if you may know more about something about the 19th century photographs, I just wanted to explain, just because of this day and age where you have digital cameras, phone cameras, you can take, you know, split seconds, so many photos. So we must cast our mind so that you can set it in the context of Thompson's age, that the phone, the cameras, as you can see, this man on the right, is huge wooden box with tripod. And so it was really heavy, but he also had to lug with him a dark room tent, you see on the left. And because he had to immediately, once the glass was exposed, he had to immediately go into this glass, this dark room tent, and fix it with chemicals. And arsenic was in some of these fixing chemicals. So literally he can't be in there for more than 8 to 10 minutes, otherwise he'd be poisoned. So because it's important to keep this in mind every time you look at the John Thompson photos to see what was involved in making even one photo. Okay, next slide here. Just wanted to show you on the right, this is the actual size of a glass negative. You can imagine he had to, so on the left is a crate. So he had to store these, put it on the back of the elephant. And so it was a really, really arduous and difficult journey to anywhere, lugging all this equipment with him. And I just wanted to mention here, you see the, so it's about 8 by 10. Do you see a photo, a negative of a photo I'm going to show you later? This is Prince Gong from the Qing Dynasty court. This is because he was in Beijing taking that photograph. But quite often, when you go into those boxes and look at the original, some of these glass, they've been cut into four. Because like us, you know, we'd say, oh, we'll take one photo from our phone. And then we'd say, oh, let's take another one and I'll, just to be sure. Well, Thompson did the same thing. Quite often you'll see he would have two, he would cut this into four, and let's say have two of the same place and one would be crossed off. So after he came back, went back to his studio at home, he would decide which one that eventually he wanted to print. So next, let's have a look at the section of the China photographs. Now, the China section is equally, you know, well known because this really was his reputation and his legacy. And this was an exhibition that Chester Beatty took several years earlier. And I'm going to split them and show you images based on themes. So this is a lovely one, which I also have as a backdrop for this talk. And this is a, you see it's in the south of China. It's a bamboo grove. And you see the beautiful soft mountains on the back. It's almost like a Chinese painting, what he tried to achieve. And because, as I said earlier, he was very interested in Western art. So there's a painterly quality about his photographs, which you don't find in many other photographers from that time. So let's look at the next one. This is the stunning photo of the Jinshan Temple. This is situated on the Min River, just west of Fuzhou in Fujian province. And this is the only temple in Fujian to sit on water. And you can still visit this same temple today. We almost didn't use this photo because the glass was not in a good condition, but I'm glad through digital techniques, we were able to scan this to such high quality. As you can see, it's a really beautiful photo. Next one, please. You see this one I included. It's just such a beautiful, an interesting photo of an old tree with it's a roadside shrine. And this image was taken in Taiwan. And next, you'll see, let's have a look at the next one. Yeah. This is the Nankou Pass just outside Beijing. So from this point, you see, you begin to see the first spur of the Great Wall. So the pass is very rocky, but for centuries, this was where the traders and their donkeys would carry heavy goods out through the to Great Wall onto the Silk Road. And it, this bit of the pass is quite dangerous, and you can see perched on each side are these stunning temples. But on the right-hand corner, I'm showing you the glass negative. And you can see how he has achieved, again, what I was saying, his this painterly quality of seeing those distant mountains so beautifully, is because it was a cloudy day, and he then painted out the clouds. So this way the sky is clear, and then you can really see the beautiful outline of the path and the mountains on the back. So Thompson was always trying new things, whether it's the way he posed with the sitters, the way he developed and printed his photographs, and all these experiments that he did. So next one, I just want to quickly show you one more. I thought you might be interested to see this. This is the Ming Tomb in Beijing, and this is the spirit way with the stone animals approaching the tombs. Of course, today you visit, it's just full of people, buses, travelers. Well, not this year, but next time you visit the Ming tombs, you will be able to see the animals are still there, and so the tombs are guarded by pairs of animals, stone animals. Now the next section, let's look at some of the portraits that I talked about. Next, please. Yeah, so this is the print of that negative I showed you that was on the right-hand side with the crate. And this is because portraiture was what John Thompson was most famous for. And this is Prince Gong, 1833 to 1898. He was the younger brother of Emperor Xianfeng, and he came to prominence, especially during the Second Opium War, when he was tasked by the Qing government to meet with the Allied powers and to negotiate a treaty, signing the Convention of Peking in 1860. So he was an important historical figure. Next one, please. Then you'll see these are ministers from the Qing government foreign ministry. So they're like our foreign office people. And it's lovely how Thompson was able to get these quite serious people to be relaxed for this pose. And he you can see clearly from the costume, especially the hat, that they're Manchus. And next, let's have a look at the next image I want to show you. He's also a minister from the foreign ministry, but he is a Han person, you can see from his costume, and his name is Minister Dong Xun. But I wanted to show you these two slides to, although it was the people in power were Manchus, but in the government, Manchus and Han people worked very well side by side. Next slide, please. So we come to a group that I've selected of street scenes, which is great fun. And today we think of John Thompson as, we call him the precursor of photojournalism. And it really started in China, where he was able to walk around the streets and then think and capture the different street scenes, which is fascinating for us today. So here is the some sellers of, well, we don't know whether they're antiques, real antiques or not antiques. So there's some street sellers of street pottery and antiques. And then next one, we see on the streets some funeral there bannermen. And because the for Manchu people, the funeral procession was a really elaborate and expensive affair. So sometimes a coffin would be carried by up to 64 such bannermen, with the women of the household sort of crying, following it. But here you see a few bannermen at rest, sort of waiting for the procession. So it's quite an interesting scene. Next one, please. This is the magic lantern, or peep show, as we call it. It was a novelty in China at that time, and it quickly attracted, you know, lots of people, because you've not traveled anywhere, you're still able to see the world. So they would have interesting photographs of Europe, maybe London, maybe of Paris. And then you can see on the right-hand side, this is the man will be delivering, the showman will be delivering a running commentary, sort of as we're telling the story. And sometimes there'll be some kind of musical accompaniment. Okay, next one, please. So in the streets of all these major cities up and down China, there's these, well, semi-doctors, and they're treating all kinds of ailments. And to boot, sometimes they would become barbers and their ear cleaners. And here, he's a chiropodist, but as I said, he would do several, you know, other sort of doctorish kind of things. And he is operating on a very painful horn and dressing a toenail of his patient, with the other guy looking quite anxiously at the scene. Okay, next slide. I just wanted to show you in this one installation that in the glass case, you see a book, and this is the actual printed size of John Thompson's photographs. But against what's on the wall of the same scenes, through 21st century digital technology, we were really able to blow them up to such high quality details. And that maybe there were things in these negatives that Thompson might not have caught, you know, when he was printing. So you can see the contrast. So what's in the case are the actual size of the prints made by Thompson himself. Okay, next. This is my favorite section. And as I will explain later, my first entree into, you know, how I discovered John Thompson's work. And here you have these scenes of women in the back quarters. And what I wanted to point out is the lady on the right. You see she has bound feet. The middle lady, I don't know, under these wooden carvings, whether you can see, she doesn't have bound feet. So the lady on the right is Han, and the two other ladies are Manchus. You can also tell from their headdress is slightly different. But let's look at the next image where I can show you much clearer the, can you see the shoes? It's because the Manchu emperors tried to ban the practice of foot binding, but because this has been practiced for 1,000 years now, initially only for women, for rich women's family, they don't have to do any work. And small bound feet was considered very beautiful. And also there's a sexy sway, how when you walk on tip, basically it's horrible because they break they fold your toes, you know, into the sole of your feet. But here I wanted to show you these interesting Manchu shoes with the platform, because wearing these, you don't have to have bound feet and you can copy that sway and walk, and it's quite sexy. So next one, please. So Thompson likes to always photograph things of people sort of doing things day in their day-to-day lives. And here he has this Manchu young girl having her hair done by the maid. And let me tell you, doing these hairstyles, it's a very, very time-consuming affair. And by the way, Thompson, in many of his photographs, you'll see lots of different hairstyles. And, you know, he's just very keen on women's hair. Okay, next. I put these two together because today you go to China, everybody wears the same thing. So you don't really distinguish a woman from the north or a woman from the south. Here, from Thompson's collection, you can see on the left, this is a Manchu lady wearing a short jacket known as a ma gua, and it's beautifully embroidered. And on the right, you can see a lady from the south with a much longer Han jacket. It's also interesting, her fan is for export only. This is not a normal day-to-day Chinese fan. So I just wanted to show you these two to indicate that in his collection, you can really learn in detail a lot about textile design, clothing, and hairstyles, well, and shoes, of course. Okay, next one, just to show you a beautiful pose. This could be from a fashion magazine of today. So again, as I was saying earlier, one of his legacies is he was always trying new things, new poses, new techniques. Okay, next one, the final one from the Chinese section. Because people always ask me, oh, Betty, you know, which are your favorite photos? So I put these two side by side, because on the left, she's a teenage girl, a young Manchu girl in all her wedding fineries, about to be married. But you can see from her eyes, it's tinged with a kind of apprehension or melancholy, because once she's married, the rest of her life will be very predictable. She'll be in a rich man's mansion. And on the right, this is from the south. We call a tanka, a lady, woman. She's, all her life, she would spend on a boat fishing. But you see, although she's poor, she's simply dressed, but look at her eyes. She's quite cheeky, isn't she? And it's a sense of freedom and joy, and her life is a bit more in control. So I picked these two just to show that this is a man in the Qing dynasty, photographing two women, but through their eyes, almost bringing us insight into their souls and some of their thoughts, their intimate thoughts. Okay, then after we finish this section, I want to talk about, so this is 1877, basically. He brought all these crates back to Hong Kong. He spent all his money armed with this wonderful China collection. He sails back in 1872 to London, where he published a number of books, and one was the one I showed you with the China photograph, China and its peoples. And these are huge albums with prints that he made himself and then stuck down. And then he built up a thriving career. He opened a studio in London. Then, interesting, let's have a look at the next slide. So a few years after he returned to London, this is 1877. Thompson collaborated with a social activist called Adolphus Smith, and they published a series of articles and pamphlets with text and photographs taken by Thompson. Thompson wrote some of the text and Smith wrote some of the other ones. And eventually these 37 photographs will come out in book form with essays, and it's called Street Life in London. And this is something John Thompson, if you ask people, photographers, this is probably the most famous collection. And some of these photographs are in the Museum of London, and they did a small show of these in 2008. And this is a classic document of social realism, offering a really sharply drawn picture of the East End of London, full of itinerant workers, laborers, homeless, and foreign immigrants as well. I mean, sadly, 150 years later, we'd say, well, what's new? But you can trace back to Thompson's interest in street scenes, how people live, you know, from day to day, itinerant workers, from his time in Asia. And this one, this photograph is known in Victorian times, this woman is known as a crawler. Due to unfortunate circumstances, illness, accident, some people were left, their lives were spiraling down, and they're just living penniless on the streets. She's helping to look after the baby, but basically she's homeless and penniless. Next one, please. You see on the left, there are laborers in Covent Garden. On the right is a street seller, you know, hawking some goods. Next slide, please. And these are, photograph is entitled Nomads. So he doesn't say whether they're gypsies or not, but they're called nomads because they travel up and down the country and doing odd seasonal jobs like fruit picking, and sometimes they would work in fairgrounds as well during the season to help out doing odd jobs. And next one, I thought I would juxtapose. On the left is these women selling flowers in Covent Garden in London, and on the right, these hawkers selling these hairpins in Beijing. And then the final pair, next one please. You have on the left, these are hawkers selling ginger beer in London's Clapham Common on the left, and on the right, this is the Muslim butcher with his apprentice in Beijing. So we're beginning to see the dual threads of Thompson's work, but also Thompson the man. He always photographed the rich and the famous, but at the same time, his heart was with the people on the street. This is something that he did throughout his life, and maybe because, you know, to become a successful professional photographer, you had to photograph rich people because they paid, but he never forgot his humble beginnings back in Edinburgh. Okay, next slide, please. So this is 1881. Thompson was appointed as a royal photographer. And this is a beautiful, soft photograph of Queen Victoria. And this is in the Royal Collection in Windsor. Next, please, you'll see the daughter. So let's look at the next slide. Yeah, this is Princess Alexandra. Her father was the Duke of Edinburgh, who visited Hong Kong, and that gave Thompson that first break. Next, please. And you'll see the four of the Duke of Edinburgh's children with, you know, the dogs having a picnic in the palace. Okay, here, let's skip to the next section. Next slide, please. So another crucial watershed point was in 1886 here, Thompson was appointed the Royal Geographic Society's instructor of photography. And this was a very important point because also it helped to set his legacy. And here you see on the left, this is a photograph of John Thompson when he was 60 years old. And on the letter on the letter on the right was one in written in 1917 when he was so old, you know, he retired and he wanted to step down as the instructor. So at this point, I just want to mention his legacy. So really, first thing we looked at was he pioneered social realism in photography. Second thing is he broke the convention of the day. You know, he created relationships with his sitters, even, you know, beyond language. Some could speak English, many people couldn't speak English, but he had a very sensitive way and friendly way dealing with his sitters so that he was able to achieve the best portraits. And if you talk to any portrait photographer today, they will say the same thing. It's whether they have that special relationship with their sitters. And the other thing is that he experimented with photography. And that, you know, back to the Siam and China photographs, he tried all sorts of techniques so that photography can be a work of art as well, like a painting. And his work as the instructor at the Royal Geographic Society was crucial because at that point he trained a whole generation of travel photographers. So in terms of travel photography with expeditions, pre-Thompson, expedition members, so those explorers going out to, you know, the Arctic, to Africa, to India, to all sorts of places, they would take photos themselves. But after Thompson, until today, every expedition will always engage a professional photographer. And that's why travel photography has become such a sort of major important aspect. And of course, today we have television, we have wildlife television, but it was that point, it was making, creating professionalism in this role of a travel photographer. So next, let's have a look at, so after he stepped down from the Royal Geographic Society, so Thompson spent his retirement partly back in Edinburgh and then partly in London, where he bought a house in Streatham in South London. One day in 1920, Thompson visited an exhibition of photograph collected by an American, well, today we call him a billionaire, pharmacist, collector, and philanthropist, Sir Henry Wellcome. You'll see him on the left. Wellcome was also interested in photography, so he collected photographs, and that's why Thompson especially made the point to see his exhibition in London in Wigmore Street, and he discovered that, in fact, Wellcome did not have anything on China, on Asia, nothing on Siam. So you can see on the right, he wrote to Wellcome's office offering to sell the three crates of close to 700 glass negatives along with his notes. So, but he had to send the three crates to welcome's office for them to be, the things to be assessed and to be decided. But then, you know, welcome was so rich. He was going here, there, everywhere, buying things, traveling, and the sale wasn't concluded yet. But on the 30th of September, 1921, Thompson dies of a heart attack. He was on a tram traveling in South London, and he was 84. But as the photographs were not yet sold, they were stuck at Welcome's office. So his children found the exchange of letters and sold the three crates with the glass negatives for a paltry sum of £20. And this is 10 years of his life and work from Asia. This was, okay, this is 1922, so £20 is a lot more than £20 a day, but even so, it was a paltry sum. But although this was sad for his family, but it was serendipity for us. Because during that time, there were very few rich collectors who had this ability and understanding to keep these glass negatives in optimum condition, because the glass was very brittle, so it can't be too cold, the temperature, and the emulsion side, it can't be too warm. Imagine if these three crates were left somewhere, either in an attic in Edinburgh. They, you know, we just would not have this exhibition today. So let's fast forward. Next slide, please. This is the 1980s. A young librarian called William Schupper joined the Wellcome Library, and one of his first job, William told me, was someone put a note on these crates that says, "Oh, William, take a look at these glass. If they're poor quality, broken, just throw them away." Because Henry Wellcome collected million objects, wonderful things in his collection, which you can see it's up in Euston Road. And at that time, you know, in the 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s, people weren't interested in these old photographs of China or Siam. But William made, he was very careful, he made some contact prints. So I don't know, some of you might know. So they're just A4 contact prints. And he said, "Oh, they're quite nice. They're interesting. Let's just leave them there." But it was not his job to do anything about these, that he just left them there. Until over a decade ago, by chance, I visited the Wellcome Library. I met William and he showed me these contact prints, and some were of the women that we looked at, and I just fell in love. That was it. And I took a 6-month leave from my job, and I said, okay, I better, because nothing like this would exist in China today. So I thought, I took 6 months off, just do one exhibition in China. But it was so successful, actually I never went back to work. So we're still touring these around the world. So next slide, please. And then you can see here. So far, we've done 28 exhibitions across three continents and seen by nearly 1 million visitors. And so Chester Beatty, we showed China in 2011, and Siam now in 2020. So I've shown you two of their beautiful installations at the Chester Beatty. They're, it's really, really well done. And then to close, I just wanted to close with a couple of postscripts. Let me tell you a funny story. Next slide, please. Just before I opened the exhibition, this in London, this is 2008, someone I didn't know, someone called me and said, he had found Thompson's grave derelict in Streatham Cemetery in South London. So the man who found it was this guy in the white hat you see on the right. So you can see, well, I don't know how he found it, but anyway, we looked at the, so we keeled over, so we lifted it, had a look, and then crowdfunding, and we managed to clean it up and restore it. And so you'll see the next slide, please. You see, next slide. Let's have a look. Yeah, that's it. So, this one. So you can see we've cleaned it up. It's the original stone, and a whole group of us, all the John Thompson fans, we went and had a rededication, the interior 2010. And so that's restored. And then one other little postscript, and 2021 will be the centenary of Thompson's death. And the Historic Environment Scotland, ATS, has agreed to put a plaque on his childhood home. So it's a bit like in London, we have the blue plaque. I don't know in Dublin, but they have something similar. But there'll be a plaque, and there'll be a, you know, a kind of a reception and celebration of his time, his life, and his contribution to not only photography, but to the understanding of Asia, to his love of people. And then my last slide is my website, because if you want to have a look, because the foundries are all closed at the moment in Scotland. So it'll probably be in spring, but I will be putting up a photo of his childhood home with the plaque on it. So that's the end of my story of John Thompson, his life and his legacy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Betty. That was great. I think you really gave us a sense of the many facets of his career, and also that he really had a very modern artistic sensibility. Let me see if there are any questions. I see a few here. The first question, what was the purpose of the wrong lad in the photo of Thompson and the darkroom? I don't exactly know what that means.
What was the
purpose of the wrong lad in the photo of Thompson and the
lad? Yes, the lad was holding the wooden frame. So what you have to do is that you put the glass, you sensitize the glass, you put the glass in this wooden frame, which the lad is holding, and the photographer, and gives it to the photographer who slots it in, and then he takes off the cover and it's exposed to light. So the young boy was the helper.
Great. One person said here, thank goodness you found the plates and took time to work on them. I loved the John Thompson photographs at the exhibition a few years ago in the CBL. My favorite has always been the young fisherwoman for the same reasons that you explained today, the cheeky, vibrant look in her eyes. Thank you for all your work. Another woman has said, are there any cards or postcards available of these photos? Very interesting talk and most informative. Thank you. And yes,
there are. They are in the Chester Beatty gift shop.
Yeah. One person has commented, would be interesting to see info regarding Thompson and silk. I don't know, is there anything
we've done
on his interest in?
Yeah, I've worked certainly from Chester Beatty's sort of the China show. You showed one of the stunning robes in that exhibition. And since then, there have been quite a lot of scholars who look at Thompson's photograph and study not only the silk, but the symbols, the patterns, the motifs. So yes, there is some contribution to the dialogue of people who are scholars who are studying 19th century Chinese costume.
Yeah. One person at the beginning of the talk asked about the actual closing date. We were originally going to close, we had extended it to January 3rd, but unfortunately because of shipping schedules and also the uncertainties around Brexit, we did have to bring the date forward to December 3rd. So we are in fact closing the exhibition this Sunday.
The virtual show is stunning, actually. I love it. Send it to your...
Yeah, no, you absolutely can access it. It will remain on our website. So please do continue to engage with that. Betty, thank you so much. That was really great. And I really, it was a real pleasure working with you on this exhibition, as well as the China Through the Lens in 2011. Actually, I see one more question here. Are there any other photographs of China from the 1870s that are publicly accessible?
Yes, there are other other photographers. For instance, Thomas Childs, William Saunders. But what is different about Thompson was he was a professional photographer, whereas all the other ones had some government jobs or there are quite a lot of missionary photos, not so early, later on towards the end of the century or early 20th century, their photos of China. It's interesting, since I've been doing this for a decade, the interest in old photos is really revived, and I would urge everyone not to throw away albums that you found after a few generations. They are special simply because the way we take photographs today is so different, whereas those days is the time. It has that enduring quality that people find. So you can see online, or if you can continue to ask any questions to Laura by email, and then I'm happy to email reply back and send you any other links or anything that I know of that I can forward to you.
Great. I think that's it. I don't see any other questions. So thank you again, Betty.
I just wanted to add that not only the postcards, but I think the catalog, the book is still in the Chester Beatty bookshop. So there's one book on Siam and one book on China and postcards as well. But I hope you'll follow and, you know, Google the website from time to time, because we're opening in different places. We're open the China show, in England, that's on till May. So there'll be new things happening, and you can sort of follow up on what else we'll be doing.
Great. So. Thank you, Betty, and thank you all for joining today's lectures. We hope to see you again for the next events, and also, as I said, again on the 16th of December for the book launch. So thanks again. See you soon.
Thank you.
Bye.